this week's installment. When he wasn't running with wild geese or fearing wolves, this tricky dicky was known for shaking his spear where eagles dare, until he got to Camelot. Cleopatra, come at you, because it's Richard Burton. And tonight, Hollywood Swingers.
Favourite segment of the show, Hollywood Swingers, where we celebrate those Hollywood stars who swung into music. I think Paul lost it a wee bit there during that one, but our Hollywood Swinger this week is Richard Burton. Tell me about him, Paul.
Born Richard Walter Jenkins Jr. on the 10th
Say that again.
Richard Walter Jenkins Jr.
RWJJ.
RWJJ. On the 10th of November, 1925. It was a Tuesday. In the small village of, and I apologise if I'm not pronouncing this, Pontrydyfyn.
Mm-hmm.
Pontrydyfyn in Wales. He was the 12th of 13 children to coal miner father Richard Sr. and his mother Edith. Now, unfortunately, Richard was only 2 years old when his mother died after complications following the birth of child number 13.
That's so sad.
And that was believed to have been brought on from exposure to the coal dust from the nearby mines.
Yeah.
Richard's father was in no fit shape to take care of the family, as, according to the actor, he was a 12 pints a day man.
Okay.
Who would disappear for weeks on end. And as a result, Burton was brought up by his elder sister Cecilia, who he remained forever grateful to throughout his life. Now, like many young Welsh boys, Richard was particularly sporty with a love of rugby, and it was believed that he could have played at some level if his career didn't go down another path.
Mm-hmm.
And that path was the arts, with the actor becoming interested in poetry and literature, as well as showing an aptitude for the stage. And that was particularly encouraged by his schoolmaster, Philip Burton. Now, unfortunately, due to his sister's husband falling ill, Richard had to leave school in 1941 to work as a miner himself to support the family. And he also considered professions like boxing or the clergy. And despite being underage at the time, this was also when he found himself taking up drinking and smoking. And that's the two vices that would ultimately affect him throughout the years.
Mm-hmm.
Joining up with the RAF as a cadet, Richard re-encountered his old schoolmaster, Mr. Burton, who was a squadron commander, and he once again encouraged Richard to perform and even gave him a part in a BBC radio play. Seeing his talent, Mr. Burton re-enrolled Richard in school, and he personally tutored him, as well as developing his voice, his projection, his stagecraft. Philip said of Richard, "He's my son to all intents and purposes. I was committed to him."
Oh.
And Richard admitted that he owed everything to Mr. Burton. Thus, in 1943, Richard became Philip's legal ward. He went to Oxford University due to the tuition that Mr. Burton had given him, and he legally changed his name by deed poll to Richard Burton. Now, after a few years' service in the RAF, Burton moved to London in 1948, and he soon won a studio contract, making a grand sum of £100 a week. But in that time, that was actually a lot of money when you were making a tenth of that working down the mines.
Yeah.
And he would star in a number of small parts in British films in the next few years, as well as continuing on the stage. And this included a celebrated Broadway run in the early 50s, where critics would dub him the next Laurence Olivier.
Ooh!
His Hollywood debut was in 1951's My Cousin Rachel, for which the actor got an Oscar nomination and he won a Golden Globe.
I prefer My Cousin Vinny.
Mm. And he would then star in the war film The Desert Rats.
Yes.
He was once again nominated for an Oscar for the biblical epic The Robe.
Oh, my dad loves that film.
Yeah, and after this, because of the success of these three films in short space of time, mm-hmm. literally within like the space of a year, the actor was offered a 7-year contract worth $1 million.
At what studio?
MGM.
Okay, okay.
And to the surprise and admiration of all of Hollywood, he turned it down to
Good
play Hamlet at the Old Vic.
Good
for 150 quid a week.
That's integrity.
Mm-hmm.
I would have taken the 7-year contract.
And it was around this time, to celebrate the success of The Robe, that Burton met an actress by the name of Elizabeth Taylor at a party. But both didn't seem to like each other's company too much.
Are you... Hold on. Hold the fort. Are you telling me they went from enemies to lovers? Because that is my favourite brand of romance.
Yep. It was also thought at the time that Burton had committed career suicide by turning down that deal.
Mm-mm.
But such was the success of his first three movies that the studio basically went back to him cap in hand once mm-hmm. his commitment on the stage had ended a couple of years later. However, his early success evaded him, and many of his next pictures were flops. His star in Hollywood started to wane, and then the UK started not being a full-time option for him either, because Burton had exiled himself from the UK for tax purposes.
Oh, Richard.
However, he made a triumphant return to Broadway in 1960, starring in Camelot, the musical Camelot, alongside a then hot-to-trot Julie Andrews. It was initially a kind of moderate hit. It was just plodding along.
Yeah.
But then the show had 20 minutes of it broadcast on the Ed Sullivan Show, and it turned into a massive 3-year success.
Can we just talk about how Ed Sullivan's TV show
was mega
changed,
massive,
but literally was the test maker of the time? If you
the Beatles
got
blew up the Beatles
if
in America.
You got on Ed Sullivan, mm-hmm. that was it. That yeah. that was your made. That's amazing.
But imagine any show now just taking 20 minutes of a musical, a Broadway
it's
musical,
like being,
showing it.
It's like being retweeted by Ashton Kutcher. Makes your career.
And this whole success of the show for 3 years led to Burton being called the King of Broadway.
Brilliant.
At the start of the musical success in 1961, Burton was approached to star as Mark Antony on a film production of Cleopatra.
Yes.
The film would go down in Hollywood history as one of the most troubled productions in film history.
Uh-huh.
With costs reaching $40 million at the time.
So is this worse than Apocalypse Now?
Yeah, this is $40 million then. The equivalent, when he was offered $1 million,
mm-hmm.
that is the equivalent of $10 million today.
So that's like Marvel money.
That's like $400 million. That would be one of the most expensive films. In fact, it would be the most expensive film ever made.
And that was Cleopatra.
And that was Cleopatra.
And it was because there was loads of people in it, wasn't it? And they made actual chariots.
And Burton also didn't get along with his co-star, who happened to be Elizabeth Taylor.
Oh, I wonder what's going to happen between them two.
At first, that is... Despite both being married,
yeah.
The pair fell in love, and they started an open affair that became the talk of the town.
Oh,
like, they literally
no.
had this affair whilst their spouses were in Rome whilst they were filming.
So they were just like, we don't care, we're
we
in love,
do
we're
not
doing this.
Care. Apparently Burton was saying things like, we've just done it in the back of a lot of it. And as filming went on, the press slated the pair like they were lambasted back in America, and even the Vatican decried the scandalous behaviour they put out releases. This is how much press it got. Laurence Olivier sent a message to Burton during the making of this film saying, make up your mind, dear heart, do you want to be a great actor or a household word? And Burton's reply was just one word, both.
Yes, brilliant. Also, what are you doing getting your neb stuck in there, Laurence Olivier? It's absolute nonsense.
Yes.
Mind your own.
The film's cost caused Fox, the studio, mm-hmm. to enter bankruptcy, and then Fox attempted to sue Burton and Taylor, claiming that their affair affected the box office. But after it, through all the publicity and the fact that the film was actually nominated for 9 Oscars,
mm-hmm.
Burton's star shone brighter than ever,
mm-hmm.
and the actor said Taylor, who then became his wife, they both got quickie divorces, helped him to be more selective about the work he was taking rather than take any old rubbish to get rich, which was happening.
I'm going to say I like that they were just open about it and went, nah, we've been going out and we're going to get married as soon as we get divorced, because there is nothing worse when there's a couple who meet in a film, like Brad and Angelina, who are like, no, we're not having an affair, no, don't be silly,
they
as we slowly divorce our partners and then end up somehow together.
No.
Good on Richard and Elizabeth for
so
living their best life.
They were a tabloid, they were a super couple, they were a Hollywood super
couple.
They
were the original Beyonce and Jay-Z.
They would star together in films throughout the 1960s. Mm-hmm. Apparently they earned $88 million combined. And you've got to think, this is back in the 60s, this is not now. That is mega money.
Yeah.
But allegedly they spent like $65 million of it. They lived an extravagant lifestyle.
You would.
Massive jewels, the finest clothes,
big
jetting
hats.
Here and there, flight jetting all over the world. The Onassis, you know, the famous magnate Onassis, who was married
mm-hmm,
to Jackie
mm-hmm.
Onassis. Apparently, like, Richard Burton would get into jewels with him to buy jewels.
duels to buy jewels.
Duels to buy jewels, okay, great, where great, they great. Would bid on, like, the most expensive jewellery and the most expensive diamonds in the world.
It's like Hunger Games level of opulence. Yeah. It's a bit disgusting.
And the award nominations also came back.
Yeah.
And Burton earned 4 Oscar nominations during the 60s, as well as starring in cult classics like Where Eagles Dare and the classic film Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf alongside his wife,
yeah,
Taylor.
Amazing film.
But during this period, rumours were rife of Burton's excessive drinking and wild arguments with Elizabeth Taylor. And the filming of Virginia Woolf, which saw the pair star as a warring couple who really snipe at each other,
yeah,
did not help. Apparently, it was too close to home for comfort,
yeah,
and that really took a toll on the relationship. Burton soon fell back into his routine of starring in mediocre films, largely to fund their extravagant lifestyle,
yeah,
also due to his increasing addiction to alcohol. What didn't help was the 1968 paralysis of Burton's brother, who had slipped during a lengthy drinking session with Burton and broke his neck.
Oh dear.
And that drove the actor even further to drink, particularly after his brother passed away years later, and Burton couldn't really live with the guilt. And then, due to all the arguments and all the drink and all the excessive lifestyle, that hot and torrid love affair between Burton and Taylor burned out in 1974,
uh-huh,
which saw Burton then get engaged to a Yugoslavian princess, but then he remarried Taylor 16 months after the divorce, only for that one to last less than a year.
Okay.
So it was not a great period for him.
Mm-hmm.
He did, though, have one final Oscar nomination for the film version of his stage hit, Ekis, is it? The one where the person who's obsessed with horses?
The one that
Daniel
Harry Potter
Radcliffe did, yeah.
Equis. Or is that an ice cream parlour?
I don't know, that could be. Other ice creams are available. And Burton was believed to be the favourite to finally win after 6 prior nominations, but he lost to Richard Dreyfuss. So having previously he won
for
a
Mr.
Golden
Holland's Opus?
No, for something else. So having previously won a Golden Globe,
mm-hmm,
he'd won a Tony for Camelot.
No.
And he'd won a Grammy.
No. Do you know that he's not won an Emmy?
Oh, is it an Emmy?
It's an Emmy, Grammy, oh, Oscar, Tony.
Oh, well, he won a Golden Globe, a Tony and a Grammy.
No.
But he never won an Oscar.
That's a shame. That is a shame for him. When did he make the Wild Geese?
Well, after one last big hit with the 1978 action film, The Wild Geese.
It's one of my favourite films of all time.
Which was a massive box office, and big, massive box office hit. And then he had an acclaimed last turn on the screen in 1984. Burton's wild lifestyle caught up with him. He was supposed to be filming The Wild Geese 2, but there is a Wild Geese 2. He's
not
in it. I
did not know that.
Yeah, he's not in it, but he was supposed to be filming a sequel to it, but his wild lifestyle caught up with him. By the age of 41, Burton's health had rapidly declined already due to alcohol abuse and smoking.
Uh-huh.
And these health issues continued to plague him. And he eventually passed away at the age of 58 in his home in Switzerland.
That's sad.
Despite being remarried, the actor allegedly wrote a letter to Taylor days before his passing, professing his eternal love. Burton's widow, however, bought the burial plot next to the actor's and erected a massive headstone so that Elizabeth Taylor couldn't buy it and get herself buried and be with her eternal love.
I'm going to say that's really mean, and they should have been allowed to be buried together, because they loved each other very much, even though their love broke Debbie Reynolds' heart. I think that that's unfair when Elizabeth Taylor stole Eddie Fisher from her. Facts. I know my Hollywood gossip.
So, to tonight's song.
Hold on a minute.
Yeah, okay, let's talk.
Richard Burton, legend.
He is a legend.
Absolute legend, never won his Oscar. And so, I just want to clarify something. So, how old was he in Wild Geese? Like in his 40s?
Easy.
I thought he was like an old man. But you're right, the lifestyle had taken its toll on
him. It really did.
That's really sad. And I bet you Elizabeth Taylor really missed him. I bet you she really did.
I think they always just loved each other, but they were too hot-headed, and sometimes you have to let free the things that you love.
Aww, I'm sad. Okay.
So tonight's song, we're going to go back to 1960, where Burton was the king of Broadway. And whilst he was often tumultuous in his real life, he had no such strife on the stage, where he was Camelot.
It's true. It's true. The Crown has made it clear. The climate must be perfect. All the year. A law was made a distant moon ago here. July and August cannot be too hot. And there's a legal limit to the snow here in Camelot. The winter is forbidden till December, and exits March the 2nd on the dot. By order, summer lingers through September in Camelot. Camelot, Camelot, I know it sounds a bit bizarre, but in Camelot, Camelot, that's how conditions are. The rain may never fall till after sundown. By 8, the morning fog must disappear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happily ever aftering than here in Camelot. Gives a person pause. But in Camelot, Camelot, those are the legal laws. The snow may never slush upon the hillside. By 9 p.m. the moonlight must appear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happily ever aftering than here in Camelot.
That was Richard Burton with Camelot. Here in the Ashley Storrie Show, we rank our Hollywood swingers on a scale of 1 to 100 Kenny Rogers roasters, Kenny Rogers being the original and best Hollywood swinger. I'm going to come to Paul first for his score for Richard Burton's performance of Camelot. How many Kenny Rogers roasters do you give to our dear, dear late departed Richard Burton?
I think it's one of those, it's a style of thing whether you like it or not, which I think can apply to a lot of musicals, especially older ones.
I love musicals and I love old musicals.
I think he was great.
Yep.
He held a tune.
Yep.
He was very theatrical, but it called for that, so it played to his strengths. I'm going to give that 70.
Yeah, I think that's a good score for him. I really like it. I think it's brilliant. I'm going to go to Lynn Williams, our offsite adjudicator, first. She says, it's Hollywood swingers time. Burton is a legend, definitely. This made me smile. Not a singer by any stretch, but a decent musical tune and performance. I'll give Richard a solid 65 Kenny Rogers roasters for that, which I respect. I really, really like it. I think that is a musical style. I think that that kind of talk singing is a big part of what made musical theatre great, because it meant that people who weren't necessarily great chanters could get on stage and still create music.
Yeah, because I think if you're an entertainer and you're doing anything like that, you play to your strengths. Like I said, you find a way to channel that and make something that's entertaining.
And I think he certainly had better range than Rex, whatever his name was, him from My Fair Lady and Dr. Doolittle, who just literally spoke and didn't do any notes. So I'm going to give him 89 Kenny Rogers roasters. I really like him. I really like the story. I think it was a very fun tale. But we need to hear from you, listeners. How many Kenny Rogers roasters do you give Richard Burton? Did you love it? Did you hate it? What part of the relationship between him and Elizabeth are you at in this stage? Are you at the early, oh, he's a rat? Or are you at the late, he's my love? Let us know. Get in touch via text 80295. Or you can email us. What's the email, Paul?
It's ashleystorrieshow@bbc.co.uk.
Colin and Brenda says, it's not a style of singing that appeals to them, but for what it was, we give it 45 toasters, which I like toasters instead of roasters. Let's have a wee palate cleanser. Here's Forever Autumn.